because you've now visualized yourself being on the inside lane, being stuck in a pack, or going out too fast. So what you need to say to yourself before every race, and what you need to get from whomever is coaching you, is positive, precise instructions. So rather than saying don't go out too fast, you say, I want you to go out and stick to 20th place, or go out in a 504 mile. Instead of saying don't get stuck in the pack, say stay clear of an obstruction, or say stay to the outside. Tell yourself exactly what it is you have to do. Because if you don't tell yourself exactly what it is you have to do, you're probably going to do what it is you're telling yourself not to do. Any questions about that? So keep it positive. All right, how can you help yourself be a better runner knowing that you got to keep things positive? Well, we use something called affirmations. An affirmation is short, positive, and present. An affirmation is like this. Let's say I want to run a 4:59 mile. My affirmation is, I am a 4:59 miler. It's short, right? It's easy to remember. I am a 4:59 miler. It's positive. It's a 4:59 miler. I'll give you an example of what not to do later. And it's present. It's I am. Now, you might not actually be a 4:59 miler yet. You might be a 5:23 miler, and you're just trying to get down to 4:59. But you tell yourself you are a 4:59 miler, and your subconscious mind starts to believe you're a 4:59 miler, and then you actuate, you have a greater chance of actually running the 4:59. Right? I mean, there's no magic to sports psychology. We can't make you do something that your body's not capable of doing. All we try to do is get your brain to allow yourself to run as fast as your body's capable of running. So by using affirmations, like let's say that you have a particular weakness. Let's say you're really weak on hills, right? You're really weak on uphills, right? Tell yourself, I'm a strong uphill runner, or I like hills. I run well uphill, or I stick with the pack uphill. Something of that nature. You tell yourself what it is you want to do, or what you are, and your subconscious mind is much more likely to believe it. Now you tell me whether this is a good affirmation or a bad affirmation. I'm not a slow runner. Why? Very good. I am going to break the 5-minute mile.
No, it's not present.
It's not present. It's I am going to. It's not I am now, right? How about I am a sub-5 miler? Yeah, trapped you on that one. What's it mean to be a sub-5 miler? So when you think about that, when you visualize that, what do you see?
Five.
So when you say, I want to be a sub-5 miler, what you're really telling yourself is you're going to run 5 flat. And I can't tell you how many hundreds of times I've seen athletes say, yeah, I'm just going to break 9:10 today. And they run 9:10. Or I'm going to break 17:30 today. And they run 17:30. Because that's what they're visualizing. They're visualizing the raw numbers, the 17:30. So what you have to tell yourself, what does it mean to be a sub-5 miler? 4:59. You say to yourself, I am a 4:59 miler, rather than I am a sub-5-minute miler. Right? So you get that visual image. You see that 4:59 in your head. And you help improve the chances of you being a 4:59 miler. So affirmations are short, they're positive, and they're present. Okay, let's move to number 3. Number 3, relaxation. Be relaxed. Coaches in America have modeled almost all of their coaching ideas off of an archaic system that works well for football. And that's to yell and to scream and to try to get you pumped up and motivated. And that might work in football. I mean, if you're going to take a hit from a 300-pound lineman, you want to be pumped up, right? You want to be as tight as you possibly can be. Otherwise, you're gonna fly from here to California. But when you're playing golf and you're using very fine motor tactic, when you're using using a very finite motor skill, like it's a highly trained motor skill, you don't want to be like, yeah, I'm gonna hit that ball, right? Because it's gonna go off, hit some dork in the head, right? You have to be relaxed. But coaches in America often think that you need to be pumped up, that you need to be excited. And in the field of distance running, that's not the case. In the field of distance running, you need to be loose and relaxed. You need to be loose and relaxed for a lot of reasons. One reason is that every working muscle has an opposing muscle. So when your arm goes forward, there's another muscle that's supposed to be relaxed at that point. And then that muscle pulls your arm back. Let me give you an example. Watch my turnover right here, right? 1, 2, 3, 4. Nice and easy, right? This is taking no energy at all. I mean, this is just incredibly easy, right? Now, I can go the same speed, but with a great deal of effort, right? Same speed, much more effort, because my muscles are fighting each other. As the one is pulling forward, the other one's contracting and saying, no, no, no. And that uses a great deal of energy, and that makes it really hard to run fast when you're fighting yourself all the way. And you see, when you're nervous, you tend to tense up. So I'm going to ask you all to do something here. I'm going to ask you all to yell at the top of your lungs, and as you yell, I want you to feel the tension in your neck and your shoulders. Ready? Scream. Yeah. All right. Now, let's try it again. Let's try to get you to yell. Now that you know, I mean, you felt it, right? How many felt the tension? Sure. All right, you felt the tension. So now that you know that you get tense, if you're standing there on the line and you're nervous and you're scared and your teammates are like, yeah, man, you know, we got to go out there, we got to kick butt, all you're doing is getting anxious and nervous and tense. And when these muscles tense up, they slow down the revolutions in which your arms travel. And because every time your right arm goes forward, your left leg goes forward, if you slow this down, you're also going to slow that down. In other words, you're fighting yourself. Getting overly excited for races tends to be a curse in the field of distance running. You've got to keep things relaxed. You see, everybody actually has their own individual zone. We call it an individual zone of arousal. And there's basically, well, here's what we used to think. We used to think in the old days that this is really from football and from a few other sports like perhaps weightlifting. We used to think that the more tension you had, the more arousal you had, the better your performance. You just get better and better and better. The more psyched up, the more pumped up you were, the better you were going to do. And we applied that to all sports. And then we came along and we were like, no, it seems like what it really is you. But if you get too much, you start to go back down the other side. You start to lose it, right? And any of you have ever bombed a race? Any people ever bomb a race out here? Come on, be honest. Put your hand up if you ever bombed a race. All right. Most of us have. The reason people bomb races is because too much tension, particularly too much psychological tension. And we call this the catastrophe theory. And this is how this one goes. Goes something like this. All right, you go out to run a race, and it's just you and one teammate, and it's a time trial that you have to run, right? No, you don't have to run it. You and your teammate just decided to run 3 miles hard for fun, right? So you do like this. Yeah, no, why would you do that, right? And then you go out there with you, your teammate, and a couple other teammates, and you're all running this 3 mile, you're all sort of racing this 3 mile together for fun, right? You get better. Now your coach comes out there with a watch and says, yeah, I think I'll time you guys while you do it. Get a little better. And now your boyfriend or girlfriend comes out and says, yeah, I want to watch you guys do this too. So you want to look good, right? So you do a little better. And now maybe it's a dual meet. You've got some teams out there with another color uniform on. And you do a little better. You get the picture here. We're doing this, right? We're going up. You get to pre-league meets, you're doing better, right? You get to early season meets, you're doing all right. You get to seasonal meets, you're doing better. And then you get to the league championship, all right? And maybe your favorite to win or something, or you want to run faster than you've ever run or whatever. And for many athletes, all of a sudden, boom, you don't do better. We call that the catastrophe theory. When you bomb, we call that the catastrophe theory. And that says too much pressure. Now, the chances of you having had such a weak race compared to what you've just run the week before, chances are it's not physical. I mean, if you've overtrained, you know, if you spent, you know, the last 7 days before your league meet running really hard, then yeah, you could be fatigued going into it. But, you know, most athletes don't do that, right? Most athletes rest before the big one. If you've bombed the big one, chances are it's because there's too much pressure. And here's the thing. There are basically three types of runners. Most of them are like this. Very few of them are like this. I call these guys woodchucks, because they're the ones that have done anything all season long. It's like, You know, they've been back of the pack all season long, and then all of a sudden you get to the final meet, and boom, they come out of nowhere and they win it. And it's like, God, where did she come from? And the answer is, she needed a lot more pressure before she was going to excel. And some athletes are like this. They do better and better and better to a certain point, and then they start to downtrot. They come down the other side. Most distance runners, that's what we do. All right? If there's too much pressure, we bomb. Now, this is interesting because all of American media tells you that the way to be a great athlete is to get psyched up, right? I mean, we bring sports psychologists in, we call them motivational speakers, like you need more pressure to perform. You don't need more pressure to perform. In fact, as the season goes along, there's more pressure automatically, right? I mean, there's not a whole lot of pressure in a preseason time trial. And then in a preseason meet, there's not a whole lot of pressure. And then in league meets, there's a little bit of pressure. And then by the time you get up to the championship meet, right, there's a lot of pressure already just because it's already the big meet. So we often do things to psych ourselves up. We have special spaghetti dinners that we've never done before. Or we buy special shoes. Or we all put ribbons in our hair for the first time. Or we listen to, you know, Rocky theme music to get ourselves all pumped up, when what we really need to be doing is relaxing and calming down. And I find that one of the best ways to handle this type of pressure, that athletes perform best when they're in a good, happy mood before the race, like a joking mood, a jovial mood. They're having a good time. One of the things I recommend that athletes do is they consider that every run is just another day in the park. It's just another race. That's all it is. It's just another race. You go out and you do it, you do the warm-up the same way you've always done the warm-up. Nothing new, nothing special, nothing fancy. The big pep talks that we all think are supposed to, you know, motivate us to run that extra PR, chances are it's going to backfire. But it's hard. I mean, I've been a coach for years. Trust me, I know. It's like, here you are. Your team is good. They're on the verge of running the goal for the season. You know, you're in the running. You know you can do it. And, man, you're excited. You just want to be like, okay, guys, this is it. This is it. But that type of attitude is what's much more likely to lead to this than just saying, all right, have a fun run. Seniors often do this, seniors in high school. They often say, this is my last race. Most seniors in high school on their last race don't have a very good race because they put far too much pressure on themselves to do well. You need to let the meat hang off the bones. You need to be relaxed. You need to be in a good mood. What I recommend athletes do right before the race is, first of all, warm up together as a team. And this is when every team's got the comedian, right? This is the one that all season long the coach has been yelling at because you're not taking things seriously, right? Well, this is one time where the comedian comes along and really breaks the ice. The comedian comes along and is cracking jokes and it's got people laughing and you're all in a good mood and you sit and you stretch and you do the exact same stretching routine you've always done because that's the way you do it. And you're talking about stuff, you know, you're not talking about the race. You've done the race before. You know how to run races. Now is not the time for last minute instructions on you got to do this, you got to do that. That should be done days earlier. You know, like you've got to beat so-and-so and you've got to hang with so-and-so. That should have been done a long time ago. Right now is your time to have fun. Relax, laugh, enjoy it. Then you go out to the starting line and you've got your team out there with you, right? And if you're varsity, whatever, you've got seven on the line. Grab a kid, let me borrow your arms for a second again. Stand up. Just take your teammates' arms like this. Just shake them out a little bit, like that, and then turn them around, right? Hit the pressure points in here, give them a little massage in the shoulders, and you can feel the pressure, you can feel the tension will just fall out. And then he would turn around and do it to his teammate, right? You know, partner up, that sort of thing. You know, you often see teams, you know, they're all standing there massaging each other's shoulders, and they all turn around and massage each other's shoulders, right? Get the pressure points in the back of the neck right here so that you create relaxation in the shoulders, so that you're loose and relaxed. And then right before the gun goes off, I recommend athletes do, I call it standing relaxation. Right before the gun goes off, you know, instead of doing this, you know, and now the tension mounts,